trial in hypovolemic shock. The way it works is, we have been able to, there is 60 to 70% of our blood is pooled on the venous side, and that is effectively not circulating. This is a highly selective alpha-2B agonist in very low dose, and alpha-2B receptors are located on venous side, so it constricts those and diverts that blood into the systemic circulation, and we can sustain life for a day or two. So using that that technology, and if we go a little bit of that dose also is alpha-2A, which is sympatholytic. So what this compound does is you give intravenously, the venous blood comes to the heart, and heart, because of Starling's law, pumps more blood, and that goes to systemic circulation, arterial, and because of alpha-2A, little bit of activity, the arteries are dilated, so end organ perfusion is. So it's an ideal situation for treatment of hypovolemic shock. In Greece, we did extensive collaboration, and we found that in spine studies, it has come out to be beautiful, much better than results which we were getting. So now phase two is about to start. Let us see where it goes. In the meantime, I had a meeting with US FDA, and US FDA also has given us in writing.
You will be doing it on road accidents? Or?
Yeah, phase two, there are 10 hospitals which have been selected nationwide in India, different hospitals distributed all across the country. So
wherever there is hypovolemic shock cases.
So then, yeah. So basically the protocol is, as soon as systolic blood pressure goes below 90, the protocol will kick in to resuscitate. And if they are not able to resuscitate using typical dobutamine and all that, then along with dobutamine, this will be added. So the standard protocol will maintain, it's and this will be additional. So next...
So there will be one group receiving the conventional medical management.
Yeah. Okay. So this basically, I have described that Australia, these are little bit old slides, but a lot of more patents have been issued. And this shows that pre-IND meeting with FDA, but we already have the pre-IND, and I have the notes with, I mean, all the written agreement is there to initiate phase two in United States also. So phase two in India is about to start, and phase two.
Who is doing this phase two?
Phase two.
Your company is doing.
Yeah,
it?
Yeah. Okay. So next one, the next technology is, because this compound now, I mean, the more you know about the compound or detail of something, the more you can think of new ideas, because this was clonidine-like structure we saw. Clonidine is used also as an analgesic for when we can inject into the spinal canal, and it becomes an analgesic. And dexmedetomidine is a very powerful analgesic which is used in market all the time. So we thought, let us study post-operative pain, and we found that it is an effective post-operative pain model. Next one.
And where exactly and it works? Is it at the
pain? We are giving intravenously, and it is
central level, or
it works central. So alpha-2A activity. Mm-hmm. But we need a higher dose. So we are not going to do any clinical trials in this, because a higher dose, when we are, first is resources, we are putting all our resources here instead of here. Next slide, please. Thank you. And the important thing is that this compound does not have sedative effect compared to clonidine and all that. They have sedation. Then this compound, hypotension is very, very short-lived. Clonidine has severe fall in blood pressure. This compound does not produce hypothermia. Clonidine does. So there are advantages of this compound compared to clonidine and dexmedetomidine. So, but those advantages are limited to ambulatory surgeries. Like, for example, day surgery, we don't want sedation. In long-term, sedation may be needed, but in day surgery, so that is the target market, which we are thinking that we can target that. But right now, subject to availability of funds, we will do the clinical trials for that. Next slide, please. This is a unique story which came up recently. What happened was, So what happened was, my collaborator in Greece, Professor Theodore Xanthos, he's the president of European Cardiac Arrest Society. So he said that, give me some compound, I want to test it for cardiac arrest. I said, I don't know the mechanism and all that. Okay, give it to me, but I think it should be effective. So based on the pharmacology which we have. So what he did was 8 minutes of ventricular fibrillation, cardiac arrest was produced, and then adrenaline is used along with chest compression and whatever the standard protocol for resuscitation. And what he found was with adrenaline, 4 out of 10, these are female pigs, 4 out of 10, they recovered, so 40%. And when this compound was added along with adrenaline, 10 out of 10. And none, he told me, none had neurological deficit. And spontaneous circulation came 24 hours, and they had higher coronary perfusion pressures and all that. So the same compound, we have already done phase one clinical trials, and that is where I was talking to Balram Bhargav, who is in All India Institute. When I told him about this, he said that I want to participate in the trial for cardiac arrest. So we will see if we can join hands and team up with Balram to move forward in cardiac arrest. Next slide. So I'm giving you a little bit of brief coming to the main topic. Another discovery which we made is for diabetic ketoacidosis. You know that I work a lot on endothelin, and we came across a lot of literature indicating that when we use endothelin and A antagonist, the response to insulin can become better. So insulin responsiveness can increase. So next, so what we did was we selected this compound BQ123 or PMZ123 and gave it in a diabetic ketoacidosis status, and it became, within span of 4 hours, the ketone bodies, the blood ketone level came back to normal. So the response to insulin increased so much that so initially we were targeting for cerebral edema also, because this compound endothelin A antagonist can decrease the sympathetic drive and can basically reduce the what happens in cerebral edema is, because brain is fixed, the swelling in the brain leads to herniation of the brain into the spinal canal, and that triggers massive sympathetic discharge leading to arrhythmias and pulmonary edema and death. That's the mechanism. So endothelin A antagonist, our previous research was showing, can reduce that sympathetic activity. So combination of increased insulin response along with reduced sympathetic activity, we thought that we can use in cerebral edema for diabetic ketoacidosis. So we applied for orphan drug status. Orphan drug status is if there are patients less than 200,000, then you can get orphan status. Then in the meantime, FDA, they asked for face-to-face meeting, but in the meantime, US patent got issued. So our US patent got issued. So I thought, now there is not much of interest in pursuing just for cerebral edema, pursue for the whole diabetic ketoacidosis. So as a company, we decided not to go for orphan status, but go for fast track status. So then we have a pre-IND meeting with the FDA. So this pre-IND meeting has been done. We have the minutes from FDA, and they will give us permission to do phase two clinical trials. There are some pre-clinical studies to be done, but they are saying that do it in adult population with diabetic ketoacidosis instead of children. We propose children, we have to move on to adults. Next. So diagnostic, this is a compound PMC-1620. I accidentally discovered, the idea was that it's a highly selective ETB receptor agonist. And if we know the physiology of human body, they are vascular, there are ETA receptors and endothelin B receptors. So endothelin B are on the vasodilators and A are constrictors, and this is a B agonist. So we thought that when tumor grows, angiogenesis takes place. So but angiogenesis, the first part in angiogenesis, formation of endothelial cells, and smooth muscle cells are formed much later. So the idea came that why not give this compound in a tumor model and see what happens to tumor blood flow. So we found that tumor blood flow increases for almost 2 hours after giving this compound and then comes back to normal. But the normal skin, normal muscles did not show any response, because ETA and B were balancing, and the fastest growing part of tumor was showing the maximum response. And that became logical, that that smooth muscles are not there, so the constrictor receptors are lacking while the dilator receptors are there. So we thought that because we have a window of 2 hours, during that time give chemotherapy. So we did that, and a close to 400% increase in chemotherapy took place, a delivery took place during tumors. And that technology was licensed to Spectrum Pharmaceuticals in US. They are doing phase 2 clinical trials. In the meantime, one of the student, he said that, Dr. Gulati, if you can enhance the delivery of cancer chemotherapy, why we can see the using ultrasound the diameter of the vessels and diagnose whether a lump in the body is malignant or non-malignant. So that idea became for this diagnostic tumor, and we licensed it to a company in India, and they are doing phase 3 clinical trial.
So next what type of imaging?
Ultrasound. Breast cancer, right now they are targeting on breast cancer. Next one. So this now US patent is issued and European patent both are issued. India is already issued, and they are doing the this is the registry for the phase 3 clinical trial. Next one. And then we have the stroke, which I'm going to talk about today. So, and I'll be quick, because this we are now embarking on phase 2 clinical trial very soon. So this is the same compound as here, and this idea came that once again endothelin B receptors are there, they are vasodilators. Now look at blood-brain barrier or the cerebral vessels. Cerebral vessels have tight junctions, so this peptide, if we give intravenously, it will not leak out. If it doesn't leak out, it will not act on A receptors to constrict. It will be B, so it will be a dilator. So it can be used in stroke. So that idea came, and we tried, and it worked. But then the future work was eye-opening, which I'll go in detail as we go along. Next slide, please. Thank you. So this also, a lot of patents have been issued. This is some old US, China, Japan, Australia, European Union patents are issued, and we are embarking on human studies now. Next one.
Which one you have already licensed? I saw one product is already licensed. You are
imaging.
Imaging one is licensed to Venus.
And some new startups also. You have some six startups.
Yes. So I will go with the. So this, we systematically try to research what happens in this paper prompted us to get into neurogenesis. We were not into neurogenesis, but this paper prompted us. What they did was, in animals they had shown that there is neurogenesis, but there was one paper which was published in which they gave BRDU to cancer patients, humans, BRDU, and they could, when the postmortem of those patients were done, they were cancer patients. So when postmortem was done, they found that there is neurogenesis. So that study was appreciated, but not appreciated. Appreciation was that in humans they are able to show for the first time very convincing.
Cells were replicating.
Cells were replicating. So the neurons were multiplying. But the bad part was, ethically, BRDU to humans is not ethically permissible. So that study was never allowed. So it was appreciated that you have done for the first time in humans a thing which was not done, but nobody else will be allowed to replicate that. Then this technology came where C14, wherever previously there were a lot of atomic explosions which were taking place, tests in the air. They were not underground. So in countries North Korea was one, and even in Russia there were some. So there was exposure of these atomic radiations in milk, and and other things, atmosphere, so they were all being consumed in the humans. And they had the technology, recently they developed the technology to detect that specific radioactivity and detect that specific isotope into the brain using the scanning techniques. And they, this paper in Nature Neuroscience, C14. So they were able to replicate that finding that neurogenesis in humans is taking place. So next one, next. So then the whole explosion of neurogenesis in adult brain started. So now we know that there are hidden stem cells located in the ventricular area of the brains, subventricular zone and spinal canal. They are all having hidden stem cells and they can be stimulated to release. And now the theory of memory also is coming, that hippocampal cells are able to multiply neurons. It's very small multiplication, about 1.8% of the neurons are replaced.
But why they have used C14?
That was the natural C14 through the atomic explosion.
Okay.
So it was not given, but the naturally exposed, naturally. That's how they proved. So then the whole theory of stroke, psychiatric disorders and all that, today you will find that all over neurogenesis is those, if you give neurogenesis, there are thousands and thousands of reprints. And next slide, please. So I'm going to concentrate on some things which we are doing. Here they are using cannabinoid receptors and they are showing that they are also involved in neurogenesis. Next one, they are using GLP-1, and next slide, please. So they are using GLP-1 agonist and they have shown that they are involved in neurogenesis. Next slide. Then we know fluoxetine and all that. Fluoxetine even has been clinically tried in stroke and they found little bit of benefit. And that also is showing neurogenesis. So the whole theory of depression and psychiatric disorder on neurogenesis is evolving. So this is Dr. Masaki. Endothelin was discovered in his lab, and I've been involved in endothelin since 1989. The very next year it was discovered. So Dr. Masaki, his student Yanagisawa, he gave a PhD product to Yanagisawa to isolate a constrictor substance which was reported in American Journal of Physiology in 85. And Yanagisawa isolated and found that it is endothelin. Next slide, please. And this is Yanagisawa. Last year we were together at the World Endothelin meeting. A very Masaki is now very, very old, so he doesn't come. But Yanagisawa is being already tipped for Nobel Prize, probably very humble person. And he appreciates a lot of work. But he has been always saying that endothelin B receptors are huge number in brain. We don't know their function. And we are one of the very few groups. There are two groups, one Koyoma in Japan, and we are in the United States, are working on endothelin B receptors in the brain to identify what is their function. So knockout mice, no, they can't even survive. So we were not able to do anything if the endothelin B receptors are knocked out. Next slide, please. So basically endothelin, how it was discovered was for constrictor part. So a lot of studies have been done and publication, and the drug, now there are three drugs in market already based on ETA receptors in cardiovascular. But huge number are present ETB receptors in the brain and we don't know their function. Next one. So the whole worldwide scientific community and industry was focused on cardiovascular. And that led to pulmonary hypertension discoveries, and today we have three drugs in, but CNS has been neglected up till now. Next slide, please. So then we started focusing on CNS, and ETB receptor is an important regulatory supporting the survival of hippocampus in postnatal development. This paper came out in 2004. So ETB and postnatal development. Next slide, please. I'll go through very quickly. So we started studying that, okay, let us go with very, very basic thing. When birth occurs, so rats were born, we started studying the receptors ET, A and B and their expression in every in the major organs like heart. Heart, postnatal development, day 1, 7, 14, 28, no change. Next slide. ET, A receptors, ET, B in heart, no change. Next slide, please. Kidney, ET, A, no change. Next slide. ET, B, kidney, no change. Next slide. Brain, ET, A, no change. Next slide. Brain, ET, B, 28-day, huge fall. That was very surprising. So next slide, please. So we, our hypothesis started developing that ETB receptors in the brain are very, very important for brain development. Next slide. And then this is the confocal staining. Day one, this green is all ETB receptors. So you can see that intensity goes down, down, down. So why ETB intensity is going down? We know that when the child develops, the brain is still not fully mature and it takes about 1.5 years to 2 years for the brain to mature. By that time, the neurons are multiplying and dying. Both is taking place. And our hypothesis started evolving that ETB receptors in the brain are very important for development. Once the brain develops, they are no longer needed, so the expression is going down. So here they are important and then developed. I mean 14 and 28 day, 14 day is equivalent to almost like 1 year of human in rat. And that is where expression has gone down significantly. Next slide, please. So quantitatively you can see, I mean all these are multiple quantitative and all statistical and I won't go in detail, but ETB intensity is going down in cortex, subventricular zone and all that. Next slide, please. And this is another picture which where blood vessels, ETB receptor intensity in blood vessels is increasing from day 1 to day 14. In brain it is decreasing, but blood vessels is increasing. So next one. So here ETB intensity, blood vessels increasing, brain it is decreasing. Next. So then we thought that why not give IRL-1620 on day 14. Now IRL-1620 is a highly selective ETB agonist. So we thought, let us see if we give IRL-1620 and stimulate ETB receptors, what happens to the nerve growth factor and VEGF and all those activity, whether we can create super babies or not. But nothing happens. I mean, we can see that 28 day without IRL-1620 or with IRL-1620 is more or less the same. Next one. So same is subventricular zone, nerve growth factor is not much of change. Next. So quantitatively also it is between IRL-1620 and although nerve growth factor intensity itself is decreasing with age, but IRL-1620 is not doing anything. Next. So IRL-1620, no change. And here, nerve growth intensity, that itself is increasing. Next slide, please. So here, nerve growth protein expression is 0.28, not much of change. Next slide, please. So here, once again, vascular, VEGF, what is happening to VEGF? There is not much of change, little bit of change is there, but not much of change between IRL-1620 and this. Next slide. So VEGF intensity with age is increasing, but IRL is not able to influence that this change. Next.
So have you noted other receptors in addition to VEGF?
VEGF, NGF, I'll come to that. There are some others which we have. So VEGF intensity, I mean with IRL, NGF is not changing, but VEGF is increasing. So angiogenesis is taking place, but neurogenesis stops. So there is something in ETB receptors which is trying to control the neurogenesis. Even we can stimulate, but there is something beyond ETB which can regulate neurogenesis, but angiogenesis can continue. Next slide. So here ETB protein expression is significant. Next. So these findings were published in Ontogeny Brain Development, it's an official Japanese journal. Next one. And then our support started coming more from ETB receptor deficient animals. Apoptosis takes place a lot more than the control one. Next one, here, this is the germinal layer, and you can see the germinal layer ETB knockout, huge decrease in germinal layers. So all this background prompted us to use ETB receptor as a target to treat CNS disorders. Now let me show some data quickly on what we have done. Next slide. So this is the compound IRL-1620. We are taking it as a drug to move forward for the treatment of stroke and CNS disorders. Next. So let me show some data on Alzheimer's. Next slide, please. This is here beta amyloid. We induce beta amyloid given ICV, and this is Meldon oxidative stress parameters. And next, this one is IRL-1620, where we can see the efficacy of this. So let's pay attention to this. And then from pharmacological point of view, we used antagonist to see if it is BTB receptors involved, so it blocks. So quickly, oxidative stress parameters have increased and IRL-1620 has blocked or decreased that parameter. Next slide, please.
So was this a pre-treatment or a post-treatment?
Post-treatment. So we induced, and after 7th day, we gave IRL-1620. So post-treatment. So here also you can see that oxidative stress parameters, this is reduced by this compound. This also reduced. Next slide, please. And memory, water maze test. So here, day 1, day 2, day 3, day 4. So here they have learned how to, so as soon as you release, they know the platform. Platform is in the green area. So it is, they have to find the platform. So memory is pretty good. We gave beta amyloids, memory is gone. So they are swimming all over and not able to find the platform. We gave the drug, platform very quickly. We antagonized it, now they are not able to find. Next one. So this is quantitative measurement. We can see that this is the control. And this is with beta amyloid, and if you give the drug, it comes to this level. But here the drug was given ICV. And later on we did IV also. Next slide. So here is the probe trial in which they trend retention of memory, where they tried to spend maximum time in the area where the platform is, and the platform was removed just to trick them, but they are trying to find it. So beta amyloids, they are all over. IRL-1620, once again, maximum time is here. Next slide. So quantitatively, you can see that in this quadrant 2, that's the most important one. So here, we can see that beta amyloid, retention of memory is lost. And we give the drug, retention of memory is very, very much, much improved. Next slide. So these papers were published, Pharmacology, Biochemistry, Behavior. Next one. So our conclusion are they are protective in Alzheimer's disease. So this agonist can improve learning and memory, oxidative stress parameters. Next slide, please. So can we use this intravenously? Next. So we designed the experiment, ICV cannulation. We gave beta amyloids, and then injection 1, 2, 3. And here, day 7, we gave the drug. Next one. And now this is given intravenously. And quantitatively, we can see that this is sham. And this is the intravenous. So it is not as good as ICV, but it is still highly significant compared to this. And the path length and all that, they are all indicating significant efficacy. Next slide, please. And even the probe trial, you can see that quantitatively, intravenous also is doing. Next slide. And then we did all the immunostainings and all that to see what is the ETB intensity, VEGF intensity. And you can see that IRL-1620, this compound, is increasing ETB as well as VEGF intensity. Next slide. So nerve growth factor we did and found that there is, this is ETB. Quantitatively, we confirmed using Western blots that this is happening. Next slide. The nerve growth factor also, there is increase, antagonist, it will decrease. Next. So conclusion is that intravenously also, it is a neuro repair mechanism can be started, can be initiated. So this is a neuro Alzheimer's disease. So, but our focus was what happens
first,
in stroke.
First way of administration was intracerebral.
First was intracerebral, and then we tried intravenous. So we thought that intravenous may be more effective in stroke. So we tried stroke. Next slide, please. So these Alzheimer's model people are, I mean, Western countries, they are very much interested. So media gets a lot of interest, and they started covering next. So Europe and a lot of press coverage was there on this. Next one. So now comes, I'll go through quickly the data on stroke, which is very, very interesting. Next. So we did 24, we gave the injection on day one, 2 hours after stroke, we gave 3 injections. 2, 4, and 6. So stroke was induced 2 hours after stroke, 1 shot was given 4 hours and 6 hours, and 24 hours later we examined. Next slide. Here is the stroke volume. So the stroke induced is this much, and when we gave the compound 24 hours later, you can see when antagonist is given, it's back. Quantitatively we can see, next slide, that massive reduction in the infarct volume after giving 1620. Next slide. Functionally also, IRL-1620, significant recovery from 3 to 0.85, from 0.2, I mean in every test it came out to be significant functional recovery. Next one.
What is the mechanism of repair?
Yeah, it is neurogenesis and angiogenesis. Both are taking place. Then oxidative stress parameters, they are reversed. Next one. Glutathione, melanthione, next one. So superoxide dismutase, next slide. So then apoptosis, we started studying apoptosis, BCL2. And we can see that the right hemisphere is the infarcted hemisphere. And left hemisphere is the control, non-infarcted. The change is taking place in the right hemisphere. IRL-1620 vehicle is going down and this is recovering. So BCL2 goes up. Next slide. Then BCL2 24 hours also is improving. Next slide. BACS going down. Next slide. BACS at 24 hours is still way down. Next. And then AKT, no change, but PAKT 7 hours late. Next slide. PAKT is this P-serine 4th, yeah. So once again, improvement. So basically the mechanism is anti-apoptotic also, besides oxidative stress. Next slide. So 24 hours it comes back to normal. So initial mechanism is anti-apoptotic. Next slide. So PAKT also is 24 hours, no change. Next slide. So summary is, there is anti-apoptotic, BCL2, BACS, AKT, all these are showing that there is anti-apoptotic mechanism also. So first we found oxidative stress part is going down. Second, we found that anti-apoptotic part is being, next one. So then we started focusing on ETB receptor expression. Here it is ETA and this is ETB, and 24 hours we can see that ETA went up, ETB there is no change. So this probably is a harmful thing, because ETA are constrictors and there is natural endothelin is there, and that will constrict and that will even further damage. So the industry initially focused on designing endothelin A antagonist for stroke. All the trials failed. So we said we are not going on ETA. So next slide, we will concentrate on ETB. And seventh day, after giving day one injection, seventh day, what happens? Next slide. Still recovery is very good. This is basically going from this level and no mortality. Next slide. And seventh day, you can see the recovery. Very significant. Next. Quantitatively also significant reduction in infarct volume. Next. Oxidative stress, all the parameters, seventh day are also working. Next. So let us go next one. and the next one. So oxidative stress parameter. Functionally, we can see very, very significant recovery. I cannot see from here, but highly significant recovery is taking place by day